Hi everyone. I don't have such a high energy voice like the guys before me, and I don't speak Italian, but I came here because I wanted to present something to you that is very important to me. First of all, my name is Eric Volstead. I'm the lead ambassador of BitNation. Maybe you've heard of it before, but I will do a general introduction, then we will go into hopefully a very interesting discussion. So, first of all, I will start with a short video to give you like a glimpse of what this is all about. But on my
put the microphone.
You can just look up the video yourself after the presentation, because I think it was not understandable what you were talking. So just to give you an idea of why I do all of this, or why I'm interested in promoting BitNation, is because I have an anarchist background and I want to, let's say, change things or see things done in a different way than they're being done in the political system today. And you basically spend most of your time just yelling about the things, how they are going on in society. You try to make a career maybe as a politician. You try to convince people of your ideas, but it's more or less taking up years and years of your life, and you don't really get to change the things that you want to see change. So instead of just trying to fight the existing system, you could just build up a new model that makes the old one obsolete. So what we at BitNation try to provide is a new model that people can opt out to without having to go through all the, let's say, infightings of politics. Wait for permission from your government to try out new models or experiment. You could just use code and the blockchain to try out new ways of organizing society itself. So as you can see here, I mentioned Cody Wilson. You don't have to literally associate him with this, but I like his quote. Basically, the statement is that instead of going through all this political career, you can just write code that will totally explode the paradigm. So essentially, the question that we pose with BitNation is, would you like to choose your governance services the same way you choose your phone provider, or just like any other service? Because with BitNation, ideally, in the end, you will be able to just, by tapping on your app, on an app in your smartphone, you will be able to choose from hundreds or even thousands of different governance systems and services without having to move to another country, because this is actually what we're doing today. Because you just happen to be born either in Europe, in Bangladesh, in Latin America, wherever, and you're forced to abide with the rules and the laws that this society imposes upon you. And in order to enjoy different governance services, you have to actually move geographically, leave behind your family, your culture, your language, your friends, and everything, just to choose a different service provider. I mean, with any other service, we are used to just being able to switch in mere seconds or maybe in months, but at least not like with your state, where you just have to deal with it for the rest of your life, or you have to just move individually. So one of our ambassadors, Tetsu Ishii, said, the blockchain is not just for money, it's there for brand new governance structures replacing the nation-state concept from the Napoleon era. Digital nomads like me know that national borders are imaginary. Our activities are global, but most government systems are still for locals only. The government marriage system is one of the most obsolete systems today. Marriage is a very personal matter, but it is being enforced by governments, and the laws are so different in each country. So he himself is a digital nomad. Maybe you heard of digital nomads. They work mostly as independent entrepreneurs or freelancers, and they're completely independent from the place where they live in, so they can work from anywhere. So they already know that governance services are not really sophisticated for their lifestyle. So they would actually need some sort of service provider that works internationally and globally. And as we don't have a world government or something like this, they just have to opt into all the different governance services where they just happen to live, but they usually just never stay more than maybe just a few months. So furthermore, this, let's say, nation-state paradigm that we live in brings some, let's say, typical outcomes to us. First of all, we have a global oligopoly of nation-states and of governance service providers, because they have local territories and they are monopoly providers in the territory they happen to be in, and they have no competition. And this leads to several things. So of course their income is taxes. You have things like wars coming from their geographic territories trying to get more power, more than the others. You have things like corruption and injustice. So corruption, because they're obviously monopoly providers, so they can deliver bad services. Because if there was competition, they would have an incentive, just like in any other market, to provide better services at lower cost. But we don't have this today. They will get taxes anyways, and they can offer worse and worse services. I can just mention a famous example from where I come from in Berlin. We have this airport, like it's literally being proclaimed every year since 10 years, it's gonna be opened, the new big airport, BER Schönefeld. Like literally every year it's going on, like more and more money is going into this, and it's never gonna open. Like projects like this you see everywhere, not just infrastructure projects, social projects, healthcare, like in many fields of governments, the administration is failing because they are not cost competitive. Another one of our ambassadors, Pedro Rivera, said, I want to create tools that people can use to manage themselves in society. The conventional law-based system is very weak for the society we live in nowadays. People with enough money or intelligence can manipulate and use it against society, as we have seen many times. So himself is from Colombia, and you can see in these kind of countries anyways that politics is merely a popularity contest. It's not so much about the actual content, it's just about who looks better in their suits, or I don't know, who can give more free goodies to the common people. Like, it's not about actual real contents. So what we want to do is we want to create tools that everyone can use to create their own local governance services. So not just that we impose something new upon everyone else, no. We give you code, we give you open source code that you can use to customize it and adapt to your local context for local governance problems. So what we first of all now offer is Pangea, is the app called Pangea. It's a D app, a decentralized app, as it's offered on the blockchain, on the Ethereum blockchain, by the way, but this is just intermediary. So what we have binding peer-to-peer smart contracts that are accessible through a decentralized mobile chat app. Why do we choose this? Because we recognize that in most of the frontier markets, like in India and China, or in many like African countries, Latin American countries, people no longer do business through platforms or formally. They do most of their informal business through WhatsApp, WeChat, Signal, like different chat services. So when they anyways operate in this way, we want to pick them up where they are nowadays and offer them much better chat service that is decentralized and that is not going to steal your data like we have today. Furthermore, it's going to use smart contracts, as you probably heard before. And what else? In the agreements that you create in Pangea, you already have included an arbitration market. There's a global market of arbitrators who are going to be competing for reputation in Pangea, who can work remotely. They do not have to abide to the same law system to where they happen to live in or where you happen to live in. No. Furthermore, you create your own law. You can choose a customized law just for you and your counterparty, and the arbitrator who you choose will have to be educated in this kind of law that you're looking to use for your agreement. And further, you can even create and join virtual nations. So what does this mean? It's not like the big government package that you have today. It's not like the whole bulk of services like healthcare, defense, I don't know, basic income. All these things are separate services. We see them as separate services, and we're going to offer them step by step. So we first of all start with legal services, but we actually offer the infrastructure so people can build upon this, and we create a sort of governance app market. So basically people can build up their own apps, and the more and more, let's say, services are provided, the more we can become independent from the jurisdiction we live in, because we already have, by that time, enough services based on blockchain that are remote and that are virtual, that you can actually live mostly independent from the government. So the case, let's say, for this app is that we have already 3.6 billion self-hosted users, 60% of which are already in the developing world. You might think that in Africa and these kind of places, people do not have access to these things, but they do already have smartphones, just the internet coverage is very bad. So we have already a really high monthly average usage of chat services like WeChat, Facebook Messenger, and so on. And the global legal services market is $600 billion per year. So, like I mentioned before, the biggest use case for this app and in general for like this kind of government services would be in frontier markets in the developing world, where many government services aren't even offered yet. Like you can imagine, for example, in Ghana, where land deeds are not even offered by the government, by the local administration, because there's corruption, there's like disputes between like locals, and for example, farmers don't really know what belongs to whom. They just occupy it and they say it's theirs, but they cannot use it, for example, for contracts. They cannot use it for loans. They cannot use it, for example, to monetize when people build buildings on it. No, it's not possible for them to for financial inclusion to use it. And what we have, we create a mesh network called Pantalassa, which was the ocean around Pangea, the supercontinent. So the idea of this is to be blockchain agnostic. So I said before we use Ethereum right now. Actually, the whole network that we have, the Pangea app, it's going to be mostly independent from blockchains. It's a mesh network that can be used off-chain but also offline, because it can also serve as a sneaker net where you can use cables, you can use relays, you can use Bluetooth or any other signals, For example, you can use relays in a village in Ghana so that people there locally, even though they might not have access to the internet, can do binding agreements on Pangea on the blockchain. And they can, anytime when someone from their local offline network comes back to an online network, it can synchronize because the Pantanasa mesh network is built in a delay tolerant way. So we can build these kind of offline communities and serve, let's say, this market that needs it the most. And furthermore, we have 2 billion unbanked adults today. You probably heard about this several times when you hear talks about crypto. So you have all these people who have literally no bank accounts, who have no documentation perhaps to be able to even register for a bank account. They have no access to our financial markets. So what we offer them through blockchain technology is basically the promise of being able to start up their own companies, of being able to take loans, of being able to finance the studies of their children, anything you wanted. They will be able to access it because through blockchain they will be integrated in this global financial markets. And if you would take this 2 billion unbanked adults as one economy, the system D economy will be the second biggest economy of the world after the US. Furthermore, we have the visa system that makes it pretty hard for most of the people nowadays to work. They have bad passports. If you, like I said before, if you just happen to not be born in Europe or North America, well, bad luck for you. So, I know that this sounds like something that we cannot change, or that is something, it's there and you just have to protect your national interests or your borders. But no, with BitNation, we actually want to do something about this. So, one of our ambassadors, himself is also a digital nomad, Christoph Feuermann, said, passports are by no means necessary. Unfortunately, the global apartheid condemns millions of people to stay in their impoverished home countries. My hopes rest in the BitNation platform, which possibly provides everyone in the world with a unique ID on the blockchain, which could be recognized as official travel documents by governments. So what he envisions here, of course this is far off in the future, but that we could be able to have like a worldwide ID standard on the blockchain that is independent from governments and could be used by everyone to have a world citizenship. So you could actually have a passport that is just registered on the blockchain, and you could use that as your documentation when you, for example, are a stateless refugee, but also maybe to have like better inclusion in, let's say, in other, let's say, geographic territories like in the EU, you will see. So this is what this kind of world citizenship would look like. We did this pilot in 2014, so already a long time ago. You see it has an expiration date. You have the QR code that you can use to check it. It has like a hash. So yeah, I mean, this is basically everything that is needed. Here you have a photo. We don't know for sure yet how to solve the ID problem, because I will get to that point later. But there's a high, let's say, trade-off between having biometrics on the blockchain or using pseudonymous accounts, because if you make yourself transparent on the blockchain, you will be an easy prey for your governments. So blockchain notarization is an effective way to record marriage contracts, wills, birth certificates, childcare contracts, land titles, and business deals. But this is just the beginning. So everything that you needed to have to ask a government for, to have a government bureaucrat for, you could do this with a peer-to-peer network and legitimize it through consensus rather than through a corrupt bureaucrat. So these documents are permanently secured with easy access, and the blockchain will prove the document's authenticity and your ownership at all times, because you probably heard about this before, there's this process called timestamping. So you can put, let's say, any file on a transaction on the blockchain, be it Bitcoin, Ethereum, or any other blockchain, and this creates a hash. And if you just change anything in this file, be it a comma, be it in the name, be it a picture, if you repeat the same process, the hash will be different. So this way you can prove that this file was really created or was timestamped on the blockchain at this point in time, then that this is the real version. This way you can, for example, also alleviate the fear of viruses. So another one of our ambassadors, actually in Ghana, Afrikaans Kofi Akosa, said, most of the properties in my country have no titles because of cumbersome process and corruption. A decentralized land administration accessible to everyone is what is needed, and the blockchain offers that very cheap. Sooner or later, the state is going to become obsolete. So yeah, this is just one example of local project that could be indulged, and you can think of many things. You could, for example, think of a gay couple in Iran trying to protect their assets through marriage, which would be impossible under their local law, and they could do so on the blockchain. They could do so with pseudonymous identities. So with BitNation, we already have more than 10,000, actually I think now 13,000 citizens that are registered on the website. This is going to migrate to the Pangea app. We have more than 2,000 open source contributors. All our code is publicly visible on GitHub. We actually encourage competition because we want to open up a new market that didn't exist before. We already accumulated over 100,000 lines of code over the past 3.5 years. We didn't come out of nowhere like most of the ICOs nowadays. We already have a long history, let's say, comparably with other blockchain projects. We have more than 200 embassies and consulates. So what are embassies in our context? BitNation citizens not only want to engage with others in virtual communications, but they also want to have physical interactions. So what they do, they offer their physical space or their co-working space for other BitNation citizens, for like-minded people to work together and to have some synergies and to be able to offer others to travel a place where they can go to when they, for example, don't know, like if they have an emergency situation. So depending on their terms and conditions, you can use their workspace or living space. Also, we already had more than 5,000 contracts notarized on our public notary, which we created in collaboration with the eEstonia program. You probably heard of this before, but Estonia offers also their incorporation services globally, so people anywhere in the world can actually use the Estonian jurisdiction, even though they have been born somewhere else. So they're the first country to have actually done this step towards digital transformation. So, for the techies amongst you, we use Ethereum, Golang, IPFS, React, JS, I think, rootstock, and codes of rootstock, and some codes, some parts of code of Secure Scuttlebutt. We already had 3 iterations of the Pangea app, but now it's the first time that we actually create our very own mesh network. Before we were trying to use Secure Scuttlebutt, but we realized it's not fully decentralized. So now we're scratching together different parts of code, and we have, like, let's say, our very own touch to it, and it's called Pantalas. So what is all of this about? So you will be eventually able to choose your own code of law, for example, common law, civil law, Sharia law, I mean any law that you want to, or it could be even your own law. There will be a market of smart contract templates with laws that compete for reputation, and you could even design your own code of law that people might enjoy using. And it's all voluntary. So because of this whole pseudonymous structure of this peer-to-peer governance network that we're building, they can interact in any kind of contract because it's all voluntary and the governments cannot track it because we have a highly encrypted service. So you will eventually be able to even offer, open a smart contract template for an agreement through chat interface. That would be the most intuitive design, where, like, let's say your grandma should also be able to start an agreement in a contract, even through emoticons. And you will be able to choose, or you and your counterpart, you have to agree always on an arbitrator who's responsible for your contract. So in any case, when there will be a conflict arising from your agreements, you will already have settled on an arbitrator who will take care of this. So how does all of this work? You can imagine, you probably know already multisig wallets. So you have wallets that have 2 or 3 keys, for example, and you and your business partner hold 2 of the 3 keys, and the arbitrator holds the 3rd key. So If there's a problem, for example, you ordered a microwave or whatever and it's not coming, you can go to the arbitrator and say, yeah, he didn't deliver his service. You already in advance paid to this smart contract. So the money is there and it cannot be taken away. The guy cannot run away with it. If you would do, let's say, transaction on the internet with someone who's anonymous, for example, on eBay or wherever, you would have no control. You could just give him a bad reputation and he can just run away with money because you paid in advance. But here you actually have a control mechanism. You have the escrow and the arbitrator who we actually have a market with reputation for. He will choose if the money goes to the person who supposedly sent the microwave, for example, or not, and can be rolled back. So these kind of mechanisms really help you to build trust with people who you don't even know, even though they're pseudonymous. So that's also the whole idea of blockchain, to optimize trust, basically, to have the internet of trust and to be able to trust people online even though you don't know them. So yeah, you can have these arbitrators, but you can also choose to opt into crowd juries, which we're also collaborating with. It's another project. So instead of individual arbitrators, you could also choose crowd juries. So all of this is just the very beginning, because legal services is the very foundation of what every government offers to you. It protects your capital, your goods. Let's say it gives you some legal stability. All of the other things that we have today, like roads, trash collection, social services, healthcare, this is all add-on, let's say. So the same way, we also have this very infrastructure, and here are all the D-apps, let's say, that can be built upon this. So we actually want people to build their own apps and to make their own business model on top of this. So you could have, for example, smart love. You could have marriage on the blockchain. Land titles, we mentioned before. Birth certificates, P2P security. Actually, there's already one D-app, B-Umbrella. They want to integrate with us, and they're offering a global peer-to-peer security market, basically. It could be ex-military veterans, it could be a white hacker for cybersecurity. And they even offer to do some sort of barter trade, where instead of having to pay them with crypto or fiat, you could even pay them through actual services like a haircut or whatever. So these are really interesting guys, and we hope that more people like them join us and build these kind of D-apps with us. So yeah, you could imagine healthcare systems, you could imagine unemployment insurances, you could imagine basic income models or business incorporation. So, you know, the whole blockchain ecosystem is open source, and whenever there's something that we think it's usable or could be integrated, we talk to them, we have some collaboration, and I think it's a really interesting time. I know there's some basic problems with the Ethereum blockchain in general, so we set this whole thing up in the way that it's blockchain agnostic, because we know that there could be better blockchains in the future, so we can move all of this to another blockchain, maybe EOS, maybe something else in the future, we will see. So where do we come from? So our founder, Suzanne Trukowski-Telkow, founded us in July 2014, and she actually had a totally different background. She was a military contractor. She's seen, let's say, the devils of this world. And at one moment she realized that actually what she worked for was part of the very problem that she's fighting against. She always wanted to fight for, let's say, change in this world. So in 2014, we started with some pilots for marriage, for citizenship, and for birth certificates, how to actually do them. It's basically like in any other contract, you just timestamp them on the blockchain. And yeah, 2015, we had the first iteration of Pangea that failed because we had the wrong conception or wrong design. We wanted to build everything on a blockchain, and we realized it would be way too slow, and everything would be public. It's horrible if you have no privacy because everything's on the blockchain. It's perfect for the government because they can track exactly who is trying to opt out and who is trying to move without their permission. So in 2015, we had the refugee crisis, and out of nowhere, we had this idea, okay, we could actually do this for them. We could offer blockchain IDs. So stateless refugees could actually use that as some sort of identification when they arrive in Europe. And Of course, this was most of the times not accepted because nation state officials don't even know what this is or don't accept this as something legal. I think nowadays this changed already because you have more and more courts actually accepting notary services through blockchain and timestamps. You just need to have a sort of expert witness. Also in 2015 we had the collaboration with Estonia. They actually approached us and it was really interesting times, and now we kind of lost touch, but I want to come back to Estonia and let's see what they built up and we can integrate this with Pangea, what we're doing now. So in 2016 we tried secure scalabots. Like I said, it was not fully decentralized, and we moved on towards IPFS. In 2017 we made the decision to do an ICO. So now we have the PAT token, the Pangea arbitration token, which can be used for the services on Pangea, but it's not mandatory. This is a utility token, this is not security or anything like this. You can use this to create smart contract templates, to create nations, or for many other services in the future. But all agreements that are made on Pangea can use any, literally any currency. You could even use euro if you use a PACT token. So yeah, now this is already outdated. This was in the end of 2017. We started designing the Lucy bot. What is Lucy? Lucy is an AI bot that is supposed to allocate reputation tokens on Pangea. So why do we do this? Maybe you know Black Mirror. There's this one episode with the reputation slavery. We want to prevent this kind of reputation slavery where people with the high reputation can basically comment around others, or people just try to get their approval. So we set up the reputation in a way that you can only get reputation when you successfully complete the contract. And the AI bot Lucy will determine if this was done properly. So this is done with parameters that are set in the smart contract, and it will detect when people are using fake accounts to boost their reputation, because we want to prevent civil attacks. I think we'll go further into this in the discussion later on. So yeah, another really interesting aspect of all of this is that not only individuals can opt out, but also entire nations and tribes that have been left behind. Because, you know, we have just this existing nation-state paradigm where the borders are drawn arbitrarily by colonial powers. You can just look at the map of Africa, for example, and you see it's just straight lines. I mean, this is obviously not the representation of the culture of the local tribes and of the people who live there. So everywhere in the world you have a governance system imposed upon them by stronger military powers, and lots of tribes and peoples have lost their voice and their recognition because of this. So we can give them back their sovereignty, they can claim back their sovereignty through the blockchain. I know this sounds very utopian, but maybe there will be tech ambassadors and let's say mayors or I don't know, local shamans or anything like this, who can talk on behalf of these tribes and help them to be recognized through the blockchain and to claim back their territory. Because, you know, in the rainforest in Amazonas or anywhere else, you know, these people have been deprived of the very place they live in, and this is just being exploited by big corporations for profit. And we could make a change through blockchain also. So this is another interesting aspect on this. So, yeah, this is just the very beginning. In the future, we will have, through our public sale, through the income that we make, let's say, funds for governance projects. So we actually encourage everyone to become DApp entrepreneurs, to create their own apps on top of our market, let's say, that solve local problems. And they can actually post their projects and problems on, here's just an example with Considerate, where you can put projects and people vote on them, and depending on the budget they propose, they can already get automatic transfers of Ether or the other cryptocurrencies based on how many people voted for it. But we will see that there could be different mechanisms for how to do these things, but I think it's a very promising aspect of all of this, that people can become like, instead of having to go to crowdfunding, these kind of things, they can already start. Another interesting idea was Backfeed. where people can like create sort of new Slack channels where they create their own tokens, and the more interesting their project becomes, the more they contribute for their project, the more people start to trade these tokens, and actually their, let's say, artificial tokens start to gain value, and they can actually use this to advance their projects. I think this is another interesting aspect on how to empower governance entrepreneurs. So finally, this is our founder, Suzanne Turkowski-Tempelhoff, and just to finish this introduction, she said, what we're doing is making nation-state governments entirely irrelevant. No government, whether democratic or autocratic, can survive without the consent of its subjects. In the same way Bitcoin has transformed the financial systems, BitNation will irreversibly change the political system and the course of history. So just to round this up, here's, let's say, some of the media that already covered us. We have been covered by Vice, CNN, Wall Street Journal, Wired, Huffington Post, so lots of things. So we already had, let's say, enough media exposure, and now we're finally offering some real code, some real things, tangible service. So yeah, thanks.
Of a contract, so you told me about reputation. Can you be a bit more specifically about what I can do to enforce a contract except the blockchain?
Yeah, this is interesting. I literally have this question in every meetup. So, enforcement.
Did you hear the question because we didn't get
yes, the question is how are contracts on Pangea being enforced? Because we have no police, we have no military, we are not like normal nations. So, the enforcement is basically done through incentivization rather than deterrence. You know, in our existing society, we live based on fear. We live based on the fear that we are being put in jail because we don't pay our tax, because we don't comply with certain laws. Rather than this, we set up a reputation system where people, maybe they can screw up, but if they screw up, people will no longer do business with them, and they will be, let's say, sort of blacklisted in this market, and they will lose access to a very promising and, let's say, lucrative market. Because the promise of all of this is that you can also have much, much cheaper dispute resolution. Because when you have a problem in, let's say, some small minor company, and you want to somehow go to court and solve this, it's impossible. Lawyers are very expensive. It takes ages for them to resolve it. You have to go through several instances. And most of the times, both of the parties have to pay more than they get. And instead of doing all of this, you could do it much cheaper and faster through a smart contract on Pangea, where you already set up the code of law before, where you already set up the arbitration process before, and settlement is done within minutes. And you can really save a lot of money, because just setting up this contract will probably be less than, I don't know, maybe $30 or whatever. I mean, it's nothing compared to how much you pay for legal services today. So yeah, the enforcement is done through reputation mechanism and through the escrow. Because you can maybe set up your agreement in a way that you need to put collateral. Maybe you could put it in the smart contract, and only if something, some trigger is fulfilled, you will get your collateral back. So you can think of these kind of things where rather than, you know, having this fear of police or violence, you could just set financial incentives to actually comply with the contracts. So the transition, let's say, from our centralized services to a decentralized market of governance service providers. So first of all, it's like with Bitcoin, for example, where you also in the beginning did not know if this is like real money, is this real value, and the value really depends on the market adoption and on the, let's say, more or less use case. So with Bitnation, we will have, let's say, transition time where it's also vague if this is going to be recognized. But what you know is that the people who enter into these contracts, they recognize each other. And that's the most important part, that you do not need the permission or approval of anyone outside. You can just start by starting. You can just act upon your own laws that you create. And no one can track back who you are or what you did on this network, on this network, because it was done pseudonymously. So what you have is just a public key. You create a Pangea. So we also have our own Pangea wallet that you create in the app, and you have a highly encrypted mesh network and chat services, where it's not only should be safe from current threats, but it should also be safe from quantum computer hacks, because the blockchain that we have today is probably going to be impossible to hack it through quantum computers. So we already tried to prepare for that. And but for the transition, I think there's interesting aspects to this. So on one side, of course, the market adoption to have the critical mass, but also you could get recognition from nation states by offering them to, like Estonia, offer their services on our platform, because it would be a win-win situation. Some particular service that they are good in to the whole world, and they would be able to get a bigger, let's say, citizen base or customer base, and they could get an additional income. Maybe it would be promising for governments that are in financial crisis. On the other side, by using us, they would automatically recognize us, and we would have a bigger recognition and easier access to markets. And I think this could be a possible strategy for nations that make the step towards digitalization. And so I think there's others, not just Estonia, I think Slovenia, Dubai is also going this direction. But we will see, like there are several ones that specifically smaller countries are easier in this aspect. And I mean, there's the two aspects, the pseudonymity and like just peer-to-peer part, and the other part is the maybe getting nation states to recognize us through some mutual beneficial agreements.
Did the answer respond to your question? It is okay. I have to about infrastructure. I was thinking about utilities. So, for example, there are some services that are inherently centralized.
Yeah.
So there can't be hundreds of different piping systems and desalination plants and water cleaning plants in an area. So I will always be confined to the few ones that are in my area, even within a decentralized system. So there are certain things that can't completely be decentralized.
Yeah, definitely. And that's why I also said before, we're not trying to substitute the entirety of the existing governance system. We go step by step with the things that can be digitalized or that can be organized in a peer-to-peer way. But certainly there are things that we're not able to offer yet, or who knows how it could be done. We will maybe come up with this in the future. I mean, things like military or things like, I don't know. But I think there's you could tokenize many things. You know, for example, trash collection. You could, for example, incentivize people to pick up trash through some token system. You could think of many possible ways to organize also physical services. It doesn't have to be only digital services.
How can I become a citizen of
the nation? So currently you can just sign up on the website, but this is very outdated, I would say. So right now we're developing the new Pangea app. You can already find the Pangea app on the Google Play Store. But this is a very, let's say, basic version that has flaws. I think in 3 weeks we will do the upgrade, and then it will be for iOS and for Android. And we will also start the browser version. And yeah, I think in the coming weeks, especially now that we're launching the public sale at the end of, I didn't mention, we start the public sale at the end of March. And exactly for that, we want to offer functioning products, the app, with some core services like creating nations, being able to join and leave nations. So you should already see that we're not like other ICOs and empty promises, but we actually have a working team, we have a product, and we have something to offer, and not just token to buy.
Excuse me. Why do you need many nations? You said that you can create, you can find different nations on the platform. Why do you need different nations instead of one that would be for everyone?
So the question was, why do we need different nations if we could just have one big one for everyone? So we are about opting out, about offering the possibility to choose, because this is something we never had. Like I said before, you just happen to be born in one place and you have to accept things as they are, and you have no opt-out opportunity apart from going to another governance monopoly, and you have no places to actually experiment with different types of systems. And here you have a place where you can do this virtually, and you can easily create, join, and leave. So the whole idea is about voluntary citizenship, because that's a big problem in our paradigm today, that we force people. You have to be Italian, you have to be German, you have to be this. That's the very problem. You cannot choose what you want to be. You just have to deal with it. And it's like a very outdated nation-state paradigm, even from the times of Napoleon. And I believe by offering alternatives, we will see higher quality services. Because like I said before, the very problem is that everything is mandatory. And because of this, the governments, the service providers, have no incentive to improve the quality of their services. Yes, we have elections. Yes, we have every 4 years, maybe different people on top of the whole system. But you know, for example, in the court system, the people never change. It's the same people. They work there until they retire.
Yeah, but you can offer different choices with different services. Let me say, court number one, number two, number three, instead of having different nations providing different services.
So the nations don't have to provide everything. They can also just provide some particular service, and you can be part of different nations at the same time. So that's something I forgot to mention. You don't have to be a member of, you can even use Pangea without being a member of a nation. That's also interesting. You can even just make contracts with individuals, or you can use smart contract templates, or you can be part of one nation, but you can also be part of several nations if they, let's say, don't contradict each other. So I believe nations will have some sort of back agreements between each other. For example, when they have some services that are, let's say, conflicting. But I believe that it wouldn't be so smart if every nation would try to just do exactly all the whole thing. They should focus on the things that they could do best, and then you can maybe use the education system of one nation, maybe you can use the security services of another nation. So I think it could be complementary rather than, like the black and white, only this or that.
Now, let's say I'm a citizen of the determined jurisdiction in with nation, and it recognizes me a basic human right. But I physically live in Italy or another country that don't recognize me, that basic human right. How the nation could help me?
So the question was, if I'm a member of a nation, a BitNation, that is virtual, and they give me some sort of human rights, but I actually live in a physical territory in Italy, for example, how can this be realized? How can it be put in practice? So First of all, it's just like the ideal concept, and you cannot do much more than just talk about it, I know. But we are building also a diplomatic ambassador network. So what we have now is more or less goodwill ambassadors to, like me, talk in presentations and our representatives. But we also want to have ambassadors who really negotiate with nation state officials to recognize the rights of Bitnation citizens. That could be, for example, Bitnation citizens for whatever reason end up in jail, to help them get out of jail, to help them cross borders with their passports, with their Bitnation passports, to help them to, I don't know, they, for any kinds of problems. For example, one of the DM entrepreneurs we have, she wants to create a digital alternative to the government of Venezuela, basically. I think this is a very strong case, and I know that this is like really weak at the beginning because it's just virtual. But here I think it's also something like the more people do this already, the more negotiation power you have when you talk to the government. So when we do something now, it doesn't matter. They don't care about us. They maybe laugh about us. But the more people join us, I think the more realistic all of this will become. They will be also interested in making some sort of agreements or treaties. So the question was, how should Bitnation handle when there are two different citizens with different codes of law? One could be with civil law, the other one with Sharia. How do they come to an agreement when they have a conflict? So first of all, I would go with the approach that there should be some sort of neutral law for depending on where the conflict comes from. It depends on the case. Like if it was a car accident, it could be maybe some sort of law that is independent from their viewpoints. But in general, I think it's much more about individual agreements and the conflicts that come from that. So we start, let's say, with contract law, basically, where you solve just particular problems coming from agreements that are settled through the blockchain. But we do not settle, for example, murder. We're not able to do that now. Because it's something that happens completely outside of this whole network. Because this is all done between volunteers, when people go into voluntary agreements, and then we can solve the problems. But if some, for example, something happens between Bitnation citizen and someone who is not a Bitnation citizen, it's a bit more complicated, and maybe we're not able to provide them with legal protection yet. But yeah, it's a good question. And I think that there should be some sort of international law or some supranational law that goes about this, depending on the case.
Is it possible to have any idea, or you have an idea of the price of your public token yet?
Yes, the question was about the starting price of the PET token. The starting price will be $0.0445 per PET. So quite low.
It's called PET. P-E-T?
P-A-T.
A.
P-A-T. Yes. And it will be a reverse auction. So it starts with this price, and depending on, it's hard capped at $30 million. So depending on how long it takes to reach that limit, it will go down and down and down. But eventually everyone will have bought PET at the same price. That's very interesting, because you make a, like you put, let's say, money into a smart contract, and you think you buy PET at this price, but eventually, depending on how low the price went, you will get more. So depending on how low it went, maybe you have like 15% discount, maybe more. And additionally, there's a 15% discount, and then the first day, like I'm not 100% sure about these discounts, but you can check them out once we launch the public sale. So it will be a reverse auction model, and there's also a pre-allocation possible.
Any limit? Yeah, you place the limit, like
it's hard capped at 30 million.
30 million.
30 million, sorry.
3-0.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
What will be the total supply?
42 billion. And only one third of all PET tokens can be bought. One third is reserved for in-app processes. So when you work, or when you, exactly, this one interesting incentive also that I forgot to mention for enforcement. Apart from reputation, apart from this is also financial incentive, by getting good reputation, you can also earn PET tokens, which in turn are tradable. So you can earn non-tradable reputation tokens to get you tradable PET tokens. I know this sounds very confusing. Maybe I should elaborate a little bit on the reputation tokens. So we have the three big things. We have the individuals, the citizens. They can earn a reputation, which is a proof of agreement. This is the reputation that is allocated through the AI bot. Then you also will have a proof of collective, which is the reputation for nations. So nations will also have a reputation. So for example, if you have a KKK nation, you will probably have a low reputation. And you have reputation for laws or for smart contract templates. Depending on how good the code is and how good the law is, it will also have a reputation to, let's say, filter out the good from the bad laws. And so these can run also independently, let's say, from nations. You can also just use laws. And there's also a business model for developers, because you need to, first of all, pay in PET probably to put your law on the market. And when people use your law, you will also get a revenue. So maybe the better the law, your law is, you can also get a constant source of income.
How do you envisage in the future passive income to integrate your passive income?
Yes. So this is something that, let's say, we also, one of our third-party developers is working on, Johan Nygren. He envisions the transaction web or resilience, where it's like he took the idea from Ripple, but it's using it for basic income. So you have pathways. So every time you make a transaction, you put a voluntary tax. And depending on the next person after your transaction, depending on their tax contribution, you'll get an automatic dividend. And I think it's a very interesting idea, and of course, still lacks the whole practical part of it, but it's already a good concept, where you can, instead of forcing people to pay taxes, you can have voluntary tax, and this tax can like be some sort of crypto tax that goes also to budgets and can be maybe be used also by virtual nations. And you could, for example, nations will be able to create their own ERC20 tokens. And they could also create tokens that have some set tax in it. So maybe they could have a transaction tax to finance their budget. Also, you could have reputation coupled with this. Maybe you could get a better reputation in the nation, independently from the nation, depending on their voluntary taxes. Excuse me, didn't understand.
Protecting against malicious or inbreeding smart contracts like things, DAO attack.
You mean like bugs in the code?
Yeah.
Okay.
Something like, because it looks like there are many surface points where you or corner cases you should potentially have an attack.
Yeah, so the question or comment was because we have so many interactions with other platforms and surface area, let's say it's also maybe a security threat. There could be points of attack that hackers could exploit. So first of all, BitNation is not a DAO. So we have a core team that ensures the functionality. And furthermore, everything is open source, and I think we don't have it yet, but maybe we could also set bounties for people who find bugs. And in general, I know with Ethereum it's not possible yet, but I think in the future, like in Aragon and others, they already create smart contracts that the contract part itself cannot be manipulated or edited, but the security code can be audited and be upgraded because it's a library-driven smart contracts. So the part of the security and the let's say operational part of the contract, it's not, let's say, put in stone on the blockchain, so it can be upgraded. So these kind of projects already exist.
But from who can be upgraded?
What?
From who can be upgraded?
Well, we don't do this, but in the case of Aragon, I think it's done by their core dilemma. No, it's done by OpenZ. What's it called? OpenZ, I think. This. No, no. In our case, it's done by the core developers. They're updating the code, and everything is GitHub. Yes, everything is on GitHub.
Anyone can contribute.
Yes, exactly. And I think it would be good to also set a bounty for.
Anyway, you would have really a very deep surface, very wide surface of attack, because you will have many pieces in your contract. Even Aragon has this problem. No, they have to be right there. The question was interesting because, of course, a system like this, we see in Ethereum that very easy smart contract was crafted and there was a lot of problem. I can imagine when the things start to be more complicated, the bug can always arrive. No?
Yeah, it's true.
Even if you have a team that can fix it, but when there is a bug and when it's about a huge quantity of token or huge quantity of money, it's always a big problem.
I mean, we're not there yet, of course. We're just in the, let's say, early stages still of developing this app. But I'm sure when problems arise, we will find ways how to handle it. I mean, hopefully not like Ethereum, you know, with a hard fork
but
after
it,
the
but downgrade. But what you are building now is an ERC-20 token, right? So
yes.
So now the ISO is built on the team. But the platform of smart contracts is centralized. Where will it be? Which kind of platform? It will be on Ethereum or other platform?
For now, the smart contracts are on Ethereum, but it's an interface between the mesh network and Ethereum.
But let's say you collect the money, then what you will do? Because I was not here about the presentation. I mean, you already tell us, but sorry if I requested you already mentioned. It will be another blockchain, or you build on the platform or Ethereum?
No. So I said all of the interactions are done on the mesh network. It's not on the blockchain. Only the final part is on the blockchain. The time stamping, let's say, or the agreements, the contracts, the, let's say, the public parts, but the other.
So really you have many pieces around in smart contract that are connected to mesh.
Yes.
Well,
any more questions, comments, criticisms? The question was about proof of work or proof of stake. We're out of this question. We let's say that the markets handle this itself. That's why we're blockchain agnostic, because we know it's really difficult, and we wait, let's say, for the market to mature. That's why we try to build as much as possible independent from blockchain. So we create this mesh network ourselves that is completely independent, so we can even move this to another blockchain.
Reputation for some external something, for example.
What is the name of the other
schools? Is something like a new world, decentralized new world, which is in Israel. Then was the reputation is linked to how many gas, physical gas, the driver burns. So in a certain way, assessing the reputation on another kind of system can some way out so sort of help disengage from the internal system at all. So I mean, you enter the system and you only have the reputation that is assessed and used by the system. Doesn't mean the good side or something like
You mean like a portable reputation between different apps?
Yeah.
Okay.
And not importing your reputation inside the system from an external system like that.
I mean, this depends on, like I said, the maturity of the market. If there's a good open source solution, we can integrate it. We're always open, like, you know, we're also open source community. We're always looking for more things that we can incorporate. And for example, Uport. Uport is a really interesting project that we follow. We wait for it to mature so we can also integrate it. Awesome, and many other things we're looking forward for others to go ahead. So everyone is doing their own thing, but I think it's also making benefits from the others in a way. They are completely autonomous. We just set up the smart contracts for them, but actually they can just fork the code and they can just do everything without Bitnation. Even just as of the moment now, you could want this because we want competition. You just don't like any of the reputation mechanism or whatever we're building right now. You could just copy us and build competition to us because we create a new market. And like, for example, Venezuela, Catalonia 2.0, like all of these things, maybe they start on Bitnation, but as soon as they grow bigger, they can just, let's say, decouple. They could just run their own nodes, and they could just be also run independently from Bitnation.
Bravo.